On August 29th, 2021, Hurricane Ida made landfall in Louisiana as a Category 4 hurricane with 150 mile an hour winds. The hurricane did over $75 billion in damage and tragically took 107 people's lives. Daly Black is here in Cutoff, Louisiana, interviewing Reed Cheramie, who was affected by Hurricane Ida. Now we're going to hear his story.
All right, guys, so Sean Mata here with Daly and Black. I'm here in Cutoff, Louisiana with Mr. Reed Cheramie. Just saying hello and wanted to catch up on kind of what his process has been and what he's seen throughout this storm since Hurricane Ida came through his home. So, Reed, go ahead and kind of tell me what happened. So,
Well, it started approximately about 2 years ago, August 28th. That's when our hurricane hit. And we decided to stay here because of my cancer. I didn't know what my medicines to go, so we stayed here. It was a rough outing. Went through that night. It was very rough, you know. I had roof damage, so I had a lot of leakage, a lot of water coming through my house. So the next day, I called my insurance company. I got a claim. That was the Sunday night the hurricane hit on the 28th. And then I filed my claim on the very next day at 10 a.m. I had my claim number. And then I started my process, calling them, starting to call them, and that's when things started to go down.
Yes, sir. So you had you filed an insurance claim the day after they came out. The next day,
about four days later, we had an adjuster come out from Southern Fidelity, from the insurance company. Yes.
Okay. So you were with Southern Fidelity prior.
Yes.
But now, as we all know, they've gone insolvent. So
correct.
It's now gone to LIGA, which we'll get into in a little bit. But so, storm happens on the 28th. You have a claim number the 29th. 3 or 4 days later, the adjuster comes out to inspect the property. Tell me about what happens there.
He comes here, and he spent approximately 45 minutes here. That's talking to me and my sister right before he went in. He went around and did a quick assessment of the house. Like I say, 45 minutes he was going. Came back out, told us that he's got everything down, and we tried to ask him a few questions. He wasn't too interested in that. And off he went. And then I started the process of calling there three times a day, 3 days a week. Did that for 6 months. And all I would get was different adjusters. And each adjuster would tell me a different thing to do.
Some sort of different solution, yeah, what will push your claim forward. But
and then they wouldn't accept anything. I had a specialist, mitigation specialist, come in to do my walls, check the walls. I sent them all that information. They didn't seem interested in that at all. They wouldn't accept that. And then my appraise that I got, you know, I'd get an appraisal for, they would come rock bottom. I mean, really rock bottom. $21,000 on a roof, they offered me $11,000. You know, and then so on and so on as we go down. So they initially sent me a little money, but all the money that I initially got was strictly to pay for my mobile minis and for my trash bin. That was it.
Right.
If I would have used it for roof or anything, I figured I'd be, you know, quite a few dollars in the hole by now.
What I understand correctly is you're getting basically pennies on the dollar in the beginning, and what you used those funds for was to mitigate the damage, dumpsters, fans, things like that,
to try to get the water and the moisture out out of there, get my furniture, try to clean it as best I could and stored it, and I put fans every day into my storage facilities, trying to do everything I can. So every day I was trying to do this, and in my condition there ain't much I can do, but I managed to clear out that house and get it ready for him. But like I said, this went on for 6 months.
Wow.
And then I just had enough, and then I called a public adjuster to come in, and I've heard about them. I've heard about them, you know, these mitigators, and they're going to do you right. So called them up, and they took it by the hand, and things have been going, you know, now.
They're moving a little bit more. You're getting a little more communication.
Getting some answers and getting things done. Now you can't stop what's going to happen with insurance companies going bankrupt and stuff like that, but as far as them, they've taken care of me and they've done what they said they can do.
Right. So let's walk through this process really quick, just so we understand. So you started, storm came in August 28th.
It hit the night of August 28th, which is a Sunday night.
Right, you filed the claim Monday.
Monday morning,
you had a claim number.
As soon as it opened up, and by 10:30, I had a claim number.
Adjuster came out 3 or 4 days prior to, or I'm sorry, after that.
After that,
right?
Yeah.
45 minutes inspection, not a lot of communication, in and out, not really interested in what you were saying.
Saying, showing him different property, that, you know, different things that he couldn't see, he wasn't interested.
Right. And then for 6 months, you called 3 times a day, 3 days a week, different adjusters, no real clear solution to the problem. They send you a little bit of money. You're doing all you can to mitigate the damage, buying dumpsters and cleaning up furniture. And then 6 months in, you decide to call a public adjuster.
Yes.
Throughout this entire process, as we know, Southern Fidelity is no longer in business, right? They went bankrupt. Tell me about your experience with that, when you learned what happened, what was going to happen because of that.
I learned, as everyone else learned, Southern Fidelity did no communication with us saying that things were going down or bad. They just kept fighting to give you any money, but I would just fight on, and they knew that Southern Fidelity was in trouble. And then, you know, talking to my public adjuster, he said, have you been keeping up? You know, Southern Fidelity's not doing too well, you know, and stuff like that. So that's how I kept up. Southern Fidelity, we had basically no communication for us, getting direct information from them.
Right, right. So when did you learn from date of the storm, right, date of the loss, to when Southern Fidelity went under?
It was probably about 7-8 months.
Seven, 8 months.
Yeah, because 6 months, you know, I talked to a few other people in the area that used Southern Fidelity, and they, at the beginning, they were getting a little bit of the money, but as time went on, the money, you know, it was getting harder and harder to collect from them.
Right, less and less communication,
yes.
Not really knowing what's going on, and then about 8 months in, now you learn Southern Fidelity's no longer on the hook, and now your claim is going to LIGA.
Yes.
What's your experience been with LIGA? How's that gone?
Well, I haven't dealt with them a lot directly, but the little bit I've dealt directly, they question everything. I mean, they ask some of the silliest questions on your contents. You know, how did you arrive at this price? And questions about, you know, are you going to do this type of work? And question how you're going to do the work, and question on the adjustments. They wasn't being informative for us, trying to get things done. They kept trying to ask questions that would bring you away from the subject, it looked like.
So is it fair to say that you felt like they were delaying from getting you paid?
Yes.
And just questioning more of the ethics and morals behind of what was actually going on?
Yes.
That sounds right. Did any adjusters come out from LIGA?
Yes, LIGA did come out. They spent maybe an hour over here, and very nice fella. I mean, no problems with them. Came in here and did his adjustment, but then you know, he used the same thing, a phone camera like the first adjuster, and just went around and took basic pictures and looked around, and we'll send that in, you know. But he basically told me to have my public adjuster's report. So there wasn't a lot that he really needed to back up. He just was getting some backup pictures.
Right.
What I was disappointed was that first adjuster a little bit time, because my public adjuster spent almost 6 hours over here.
Wow.
He did drone. He crawled in every nook and cranny of my attic, took pictures with a digital camera, sat there with me before, after, and during, and made sure I pointed out everything that I saw in this. I've been here all this time.
Right.
And he was very interested and sat down with me and questioned me as when he was finished and made sure he had a detailed report.
Right.
And that's what they got. I mean, we got a very thick, good report.
Good. Sounds like you got somebody on your side.
Yes, that I did. I did find and get good advice there.
Good. Good deal. So, yeah, 8 months, we knew that Southern Fidelity, post-storm, was going under. And your claim was going to LIGA. When did the LIGA adjuster come from that 8 month period?
January.
In January, yeah.
Okay. I have it written down. That's
this January 2023?
January 5th, I think, of 2023.
Okay, wow.
Yeah, so
wow.
This has been going on since then.
So a year and some change until you actually got LIGA out here.
Yeah.
Okay. Please tell me a little bit about where you grew up, and is this your hometown?
This is my home. I bought this house from my dad. My dad built this in 1973.
He built it?
Yep, and he passed away, and I picked it up. I bought it from him.
Okay.
My sister still lives right here in the neighborhood.
Right.
And I bought this house. You know, I grew up, I moved here when I was 9 or 10.
Wow.
So I've been living here a long time. So I love the neighborhood. I like the area I'm living in. It's a great neighborhood, great neighbors.
Good community.
So this is where you want to stay when you find something, because you don't know other neighborhoods here. You get along with your neighbors. You can do the things you want to do.
Right. Tell me a little bit about the community. Tell me about the community before the storm.
Down here, our community was thriving. We had a lot of businesses. And since the hurricane, I'd say this place looks like a ghost town at night.
Really?
And I wouldn't want to say the percentages, but we have some of our local businesses that come back, but your major franchises have gone and they're not coming back. Your big drugstore chains and stuff like that, they're not rebuilding, it doesn't look like.
So you've lost some resources.
Yeah, and we've lost complete shopping complexes, you know, like shopping mall strips. We've lost all of that. You know, so at night when you walk, it's a lot darker. It just doesn't have, you know, a town has a light and a feel to it at night. You still don't have that after, you know, these 2 years.
Almost 2 years feels like a ghost town.
Yep.
Tell me about the neighborhood prior to the storm.
This neighborhood, it was a well-kept neighborhood. I mean, like I said, neighbors got along. Everything functioned well here. We had no issues here.
Yeah.
Paris pretty much takes care of you pretty good over here.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Our elected officials are pretty well when you call them locally. So living down here, I've been living here except I lived overseas for a few years.
Okay.
But besides that, I've been living in this area all my life.
And this is home.
This is home.
This is home. And so have a lot of these neighbors, they were here in the storm?
The majority of this neighborhood's been here since the 70s.
Okay.
The majority.
So you haven't seen a lot of turnover.
And the little turnover is all family that's moved in, sons,
right.
Grandsons.
Very similar to your situation.
Yep.
You bought it from your dad, you're here now.
Yeah, and he bought it from family. This is originally all the same family, and we, you know, kind of spread, but
right.
If you look here, we're all blood related down here.
So let me back up a little bit. So you got hit by the storm. Right. Obviously, you knew that there was extensive damage to the home. Obviously, the mold doesn't grow in a day. Right.
No.
As we've seen. And over time, it gets worse and worse,
worse and worse. Yes.
So you're living in this RV at this point. How long have you lived in the RV?
It'll be 2 years in August.
OK, so storm hit. You were right away.
Right away.
You had an RV.
I spent a couple of days after the storm. You know, I spent out and to get this set up, and then I was back here within about 10 days, 7, 10 days. I was back here and I haven't left since.
Right. Is this your RV?
No. I also got to rent this. I rent everything. You know, everything is a lease, everything that I have.
Okay, so you're currently paying for this RV still.
Yep.
2 years after the storm?
Yeah.
Wow. Wow. And that's cash coming out of your pocket.
Oh, yeah, that's right there. You're talking, they charge you $60 a day. That's around $1,800 a month. That's what they all charge you to rent these things.
Right. So now you've got this RV that you're on the hook for that you're paying out of your pocket. You're also sick. You keep saying that you've got a sickness. Tell me about that.
I've had 2 bouts of cancer. I've had a tongue cancer, and then I've developed what they call a multiple myeloma, which is a blood cancer in the spine, which is a non-curable cancer.
Okay.
So for 7 years, I've been dealing with
7 years
cancers.
Okay.
My cancers. And then I had just come out of stem cell when the hurricane hit. I went in July, the beginning of July, and then I came out of stem cell and the hurricane hit probably a week or 2 weeks later.
Wow. Okay. How's that going?
Very slow, hard recouping, but it takes a lot out of you, but it's you learn to manage, you learn to deal with it, you know?
Sure.
Stay positive, you just learn to accept what the good Lord gave you, you know?
Yes, sir. You gotta walk when you can.
That's right, yeah. You can't look at other people and blame other people or ask why. You got the cancer, you deal with it.
Yes, sir.
That's how I look with it.
Yes, sir.
You know?
So,
don't make it easy or fun, but It's reality in life, you know.
Right.
These are things we dealt with.
Right. You're playing the cards that you were dealt. Okay. So let me ask you this. When you have had this cancer for 7 years at this point, tell me about some of the challenges that you've gone through as far as managing that now being in the RV and out of the home.
The main problem I have here is keeping my supply of food. I have very limited refrigeration.
Right.
So I have very limited what I can keep for it. I have to drink a lot of fluids because of my condition. I don't eat a lot of solid foods.
Right.
And we live with three adults here. I have a wife and a child, a grown-up child. And it's hard to live three people in there for 2 years trying to live.
Oh, wait. So there's three people in this RV?
Yeah.
Wow. Wow, so you've got, what, a small mini fridge?
Yeah.
Is that right?
That's what I have.
For three people, and you currently can't eat solid foods. I mean, you can a little bit.
A little bit.
You've got to use liquids.
But I use a feeding tube.
And so you're using a lot of liquids.
Yeah.
You got to store all of those liquids in this small fridge.
In the refrigerator, or just find storage somewhere until I can, and you don't have much storage in a camper.
Wow. And on top of that, you've got two other people, their food.
And you can't store anything in here with the mildew.
You definitely can't store anything in there.
Mildew. We try to wash, built up a wash and dry, but a lot of your clothes you wash, you got to be careful because it'll get mildew on the clothes.
Wow. So you've got a couple of your belongings in these trailers. You're obviously paying for that as well.
Yes.
That's another expense that goes under your belt.
Those two run me about $3,000 a year, so about $180 to $190 a month.
Wow. On top of that, so you've got some expenses that you're still paying out of pocket because you haven't received any sort of compensation.
I've received, like I said, an initial amount, and that was basically to start paying this, but it's starting to be having to come out of my pocket lately, you know?
Right. So you're paying for the storage, you're paying for the RVs, anything else?
And the dumpster. That'll be coming back. I had it here for about a year, and I'll be bringing it back as soon as we hopefully get started again to get some work done here.
Do you have any help of people helping you do the work, or who's throwing things away, who's cleaning the furniture, that's you?
That's me. I work about 15, 20 minutes, I rest about a half hour, and I keep going, and it took me, what it normally took me about 3 weeks, took me about 5 months to do, but I got it out of there. I got 90% of my furniture out of there myself.
So you've got two types of cancer. You got hit by a hurricane. You have no real help, right? You've got some folks that are helping you, your wife and your child.
Thank God I have family, because the little bit family I got, I mean, support and stuff like that always helps. You know?
Right, but you're out there, right, with this sickness, bringing furniture out.
Yeah, because my wife works 6 days a week, you know.
This furniture's got mold on it. You're cleaning it. You're going as hard as you can for about 15 minutes. You're going back in the RV, getting about 30 minutes rest. You're back out. You're doing it again like clockwork.
Yeah. Yes,
wow.
Sir.
Wow.
I did. I'm not sure I got everything out, but I did get 90% out of there. And then I got a little help to get the super heavy furniture out, but I got everything else, all the contents out of there.
So let's... we're coming up on the statute of limitations, right? So you got 2 years. I know you've received some money. Give me, what's your hope? What's your hope at this point?
My hope would be strictly to get this house and my building back in pretty much the shape that it was before.
Right.
You pay an insurance policy, you pay for a premium, and you expect them to pay out what you paid into it.
Yep.
That's basically what I'm hoping for.
That's all you're asking for?
That's all I'm hoping. That's what most people down here for. You travel this tent war down here, all you see is blue tarps, so you can't feel sorry for me, or you got a bunch of people in the same situation, you know? But that's my, everybody, some people looking for money. No, I'm looking for what's due, my piece of pie. Give me what was due me, and I'll be happy with that.
Right. You've been paying premiums for how long?
Ooh, this house we've been paying on seven. We've been having seven fidelity for about 5-6 years. We've been having it with them.
Right.
And this house is 40 years old.
So just with Southern Fidelity, 5-6 years, paid your premiums on time. Yeah. Everything's been paid.
And right now, all insurances are much higher. You know that right now.
Absolutely.
I can't live in it, so I was forced to get a builder's policy. You're looking at $10,000 for a builder's policy.
Right.
those are things they wouldn't be paying, you know. Insurance went up from $4,000. Well, I'll be paying now about $7,500 a year. Wow. $8,000 a year.
Almost double. Almost double. Premiums have gone up.
It'll be through the Louisiana Fair Plan. That you won't have to get it through, from what I understand,
sure,
from normal insurance.
Yes, sir. So premiums have almost doubled. You're still not back in your house. You still haven't got the money that you need for the house to be repaired. And your only hope is that you get what you need to get the house repaired.
To get the house repaired. I mean, I'm trying to put my money on my cancer bills, but I'm having to put a lot of it back into here, you know?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You said I'm going to backtrack a little bit. You said you've got another building.
Yep.
Right?
I have an overhang building in back here, yep.
And what happened to that building?
An oak tree fell on it, which with a hangar building, once it starts splitting and separating, you have major holes in there now from the crush, and I just have heavy rain all over the place in there. So,
it's leaking everywhere.
It just rains a lot in there.
And you
and
still
the whole building compromised. It shifted and compromised.
Right. You still have contents in there?
Yep. I never could get complete. Yeah, I could never complete it. I started feeling really bad, and I stopped.
So now you're just taking it as a loss.
Yeah.
So it's fair to say that you've lost a lot. Even if we get the house fixed, we get it back to being livable, you can be in it, you're still not made whole because you've lost all your contents.
All my contents, which is a lot.
And they're refusing to pay for contents.
Basically, yeah. I mean, they've cut down contents to almost zero for us, what they've talking about, yeah. What they've sent me is strictly for structure.
Right. In the total value of contents, do you know what that number is, roughly?
We're looking probably over $125,000.
$125,000, and they've given you zero.
About 75-80% less, I guess, if you look at everything. But yeah, I call it zero.
Wow. Okay. Okay. So we'll back up just a tad, right? You've obviously got the help that you needed from your public adjuster. We're still not made whole. Right? I mean, we're getting closer. What is the next steps for you to be made whole? Do you have a plan? Do you have any sort of strategy that you're going to implement, or what's your thoughts?
Well, from my public adjuster, I went with him as far as you can, and then I was advised to seek legal help, and that's what I'm doing today, because I really believe I'm not looking for, like I said, money. I'm looking to get my what's due me, and hopefully this will help other people, you know, seeing this, that maybe their attorneys and other people can get things rolling down here, because it's very slow what's happening, you know, and I don't think we deserve this.
Right.
To be left off on the side. I know we're not a big community, but this community brings a lot of money to this state.
Right.
A lot of money to this country.
Yeah. So how did you know to call a public adjuster? Did you know anything about a public adjuster prior to the storm?
No, I had originally called a roofer.
Uh-huh.
And when he gave me the quote, and I got several other quotes, quite a few roofers started telling me, look, man, they said, the quotes are so far off, and you're trying to fight them, we're calling them, we're not getting anything to show them our appraisal and see what it's costing. And so they advised me, you know, one roofer I had signed up with, that he had been worked for people I knew, so I kind of knew him a little, and he advised me to get a public adjuster. He said this would be the best route to do. So I had called just an attorney, just a general, just to talk, and in general what he said, his advice was start with a public adjuster, because that's where we need to get our information from also.
Right.
And it was just, you know, it wasn't any attorney in jail. It was just one out the phone book. I just asked advice, you know.
Right.
And his advice was to get a public adjuster, because that's what you need.
Right.
And I did that, and that's probably the best move I made so far.
Right. Got a public adjuster, came out here, took a very tedious report of what was going on.
And everything was recorded. So when things got to a limit where the insurance went bankrupt and that the state was lagging to pay, that's when they advised legal, you know, to get legal help, you know, because we're at the point now that you need legal help now, because they're not accepting our reports and my reports, you know, public adjuster report. You can see they're very detailed.
Right. And now you're at legal.
Yes.
Now you're at legal. Well, is there anything that you could say to anybody that's potentially watching this on if there's, you know, obviously statute of limitations is coming up August 29th. Is there any encouragement or advice you'd give to anybody?
My main advice would be as soon as any disaster here and you have to deal with your insurance company, contact a public adjuster. For the small percentage that they charge, they take you by the hand and you don't have to make those calls every day. They take care of you and they get results.
Reed, you're the man. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, man. I appreciate this.